In 1962, China launched a sudden attack on India. Totally caught by surprise, our forces suffered a humiliating defeat. This badly shook up India's national and military morale. In 1964, Pandit Nehru passed away. Pakistan saw India tottering on the brink of collapse. It now sensed a great opportunity to seize Jammu and Kashmir by force. It was this opportunism that led to the India-Pakistan War of 1965.
Yun to har parikrama.
They say every pilgrimage starts where it is supposed to end. So let us start our pilgrimage of the battlefields of the 1965 war with the place where it truly ended, in that famed battlefield of Asal Uttar. Our journey of discovery will take us through those fading memories, the many fields of battle, those old newspaper cuttings and yellowing pages of books, and the old films and documentaries of that period.
Aaj hum Punjab ke.
Today, we are standing in the West Punjab village of Asal Uttar. Like Kurukshetra, this too is a historical battlefield. Precisely 50 years from today, one of the biggest tank battles of the world after the Second World War had taken place in these fertile fields. You get a sacred feeling from every battlefield, for it gets consecrated by the blood of our martyrs. How peaceful and tranquil it is here today. But 50 years back, this place was a blazing inferno. Clouds of dust, soldiers charging, the deadly chatter of machine guns, gleaming bayonets, the screams of the wounded and the dying. And above all else, that mad banshee-like howl of tank engines, 48-ton Patterns, the trundling 52-ton Centurions, screaming Shermans, one of the men who played a key role in this war was Lieutenant General Harbakh Singh, then the Army Commander of India's Western Command. He says that the reasons for this war lay in the fast-changing military balance between India and Pakistan in the year 1965. He has carried out a very methodical analysis of this military balance. These figures tell us the true reasons about why this war took place. Let us take a look at the main battle tanks. On the face of it, Pakistan had 756 and India had just 608 tanks. Remember, however, that out of the 756 tanks, some 352 were ultra-modern patterned tanks of that era. To match these, India had just 182 Centurion tanks. All the balance tanks in our tank fleet were vintage World War II era Shermans and later AMX-30 light tanks that were no match for the patterns. Decidedly, Pakistan had an edge in main battle tanks. Let us now take a look at the artillery guns. On the face of it, India had 628 artillery guns to Pakistan's 552. But it must be kept in mind that half the Indian guns were deployed against China. The most dangerous imbalance was that Pakistan had 174 heavy and medium guns like the American 155mm guns and howitzers, and most lethal, the 8-inch American super heavy guns. To match these, India had just 112 7.2-inch howitzers and 5.5-inch medium howitzers of this type. As we shall see subsequently, these Pakistani heavy and medium guns caused significant casualties on our troops in the Akhnoor, Lahore and Sialkot sectors. Let us now take a look at the air power of the two countries. The Indian Air Force had 309 and the Pakistani Air Force 152 combat aircraft. Though India seemed to have the edge, but we must remember that half the Indian Air Force was deployed against China. If we see the qualitative aspect, the Pakistani Air Force had a squadron of F-104 supersonic third-generation starfighters which were Mach 2.0. To match these, India had started buying the MiG-21s from Russia. But these were just coming in when the war had started. The backbone of the Pakistani Air Force were 8 squadrons of F-86 Sabre jet fighters which had been combat tested in Korea. To match these, the Indian Air Force had just 6 Hunter squadrons, out of which 2 were deployed against China. We had 5 NAT squadrons, which were primarily air defense fighters. All the other fighters in our Air Force, like the 6 Squadron Vampires, 5 Squadron Mysteers, and the 3 squadrons of Tufanis, were all subsonic fighters, good for ground attack, but could not match the Sabre in air combat. General Harbaksh felt that this gap in military capabilities itself prompted Pakistan to attack in 1965. Besides, there were some other reasons too. Shaksiyate, personalities provide that fatal push towards war. A key figure who pushed Pakistan towards this war was their inordinately ambitious Foreign Minister Zulfikar Ali Bhutto. After India's humiliating defeat in the 1962 war, Bhutto had reached out towards China. His clear-cut dictum was, "My enemy's enemy is my friend." Bhutto made many trips to China. He met Chinese Premier Zhou Enlai and Marshal Chen Yi. His Chinese friend suggested that Pakistan employ guerrilla warfare against India in Jammu and Kashmir. Bhutto conveyed this suggestion to Ayub. Field Marshal Ayub Khan was then Pakistan's president. He was very pleased with this suggestion. He ordered General Officer Commanding 12th Infantry Division, Major General Akhtar Hussain Malik, to create the Gibraltar Force, with the help of which an Algerian-style revolt would be instigated in Jammu and Kashmir. In January 1965, in fact, a Kashmir cell was formed in Pakistan's foreign ministry. To maintain secrecy, even Pakistan's army chief, General Muhammad Musa Khan, was kept out of the loop. Zulfikar Ali Bhutto kept inciting Ayub Khan. His advice was, "It was now or never." Ayub had met Prime Minister Shastri and had formed a tragically wrong impression about the steel and resolve in this diminutive man. Ayub was misled by his foreign minister. However, being a cautious man, Ayub first tried to probe India's likely reaction and resolve via a massive deception operation called Operation Desert Hawk in the Ran of Kutch. This was a disputed territory. Pakistan had much better communications. There were two reasons behind Operation Desert Hawk.
Ran of Kutch, the objective of Pakistan's aggressive maneuvers in the Ran of Kutch was to test the reaction capability of India and divert the reserves from north to south so as to facilitate operations in JNK.
9th of April 1965, Pakistan launched Operation Desert Hawk in the Ran of Kutch. Pakistani forces launched fierce attacks on the Piarpet and Khanjarkot sectors. India was surprised. It rushed two brigades to support its police outposts. On 19th April 1965, Pakistani infantry and Patton tanks launched a fierce attack and captured many Indian posts in the Khanjarkot and Piarpet sectors. However, the Indian Army Chief General J.N. Chaudhary had seen through Pakistan's ruse and did not rise to their bait. Prime Minister Shastri now called the Army Chief to his office.
This Pakistani aggression ko chup-chap rehkar bardasht nahi kiya ja sakta. हमें इसका मुंहतोड़ जवाब देना ही होगा।
प्रधानमंत्री जी, हम आपसे पूरी तरह से सहमत हैं। मुझे लगता है ये जो हमला पाकिस्तान ने कच्छ में किया है, यहाँ पर भी कोई साजिश हो सकती है। क्या ये भी कोई पाकिस्तान की चाल है? हमें कच्छ में हमला नहीं देना चाहिए। We must fight at a time and place of our choosing.
जनरल साहब, आप उचित कहते हैं और मैं आपसे सहमत भी हूँ। इस मामले में भारत सरकार आपकी पेशेवर सलाह के अनुरूप ही फैसले करेगी। बेहतर होगा कि अब हमारी सेनाएं ही ये तय करें कि हमें कब, कहां और कैसे जवाबी हमला करना है।
Seeing India's muted response in the Ran of Kutch, Ayub and Bhutto were convinced that India's response in Kashmir would be as meek. Now Pakistan began feverish preparations for waging war in Jammu and Kashmir.
Operation Desert Hawk ने मेरे ख्याल हिंदुस्तानियों की धज्जियां उड़ा दी हैं और हमारे Patton tank ने इनको हिला दिया है। इतने छटपटा गए ये, भागे गए अंग्रेजों के पास, सीज फायर मशवरा। अभी जो हिंदुस्तान की लीडरशिप है इतने पानी में है, अब मुझे इल्म हो गया है और अब हमें उनके घुटने टेकाने पड़ेंगे कश्मीर की जंग के साथ।
जनाब, मैं तो न जाने कब से कहता आ रहा हूँ, हिंदुस्तान और उसकी फौज के हौसले तभी से पस्त है जब से उन्होंने चीनियों से मार खाई है। इससे पहले कि वो संभले और अपने मिलिट्री मॉडर्नाइजेशन और एक्सपेंशन प्लान्स को अंजाम दे, हमें उन पे हमला करके कश्मीर को आजाद कर देना चाहिए। वैसे भी क्रिटिकल मिलिट्री वेपनरी सिस्टम में हम उनसे कई कदम आगे हैं। मैं फिर कहता हूँ जनाब, अभी नहीं तो कभी नहीं।
हमारा जो डिसेप्शन ऑपरेशन था वो काफी कामयाब रहा है। हिंदुस्तानी फौज की जो तवज्जो है वो सारी साउथ की तरफ चली गई। हमारे कश्मीर के प्लान के बारे में क्या समझते हो, क्या उनका रिएक्शन होगा?
कुछ नहीं जनाब, वो तो वर्किंग बाउंड्री है जम्मू एंड कश्मीर की, इंटरनेशनल बाउंड्री थोड़ी भी है। ये बड़ा ही मुफीद प्लान है, जीत हमारे मुस्तकबिल में है।
ऑपरेशन जिब्राल्टर जनरल साहब, उसकी क्या तैयारी है?
जनरल अख्तर हुसैन मलिक हैड रेज्ड 9 फोर्सेस अंडर द एजीस ऑफ ऑपरेशन जिब्राल्टर। ईच फोर्स वाज अराउंड अ बटालियन स्ट्रांग। देयर टास्क was to infiltrate into Jammu and Kashmir between the 1st and 5th of August and instigate an Algerian-style rebellion to create chaos behind our front lines. The Salahuddin force was to target Srinagar, the capital of Jammu and Kashmir. Under the cover of the Pir Dastagir Sahib celebrations, this force planned to enter Srinagar. ISI agents were to orchestrate massive protests on the anniversary of Sheikh Abdullah's arrest the next day. Under this cover, Salahuddin force commandos would seize the All India radio station and the Srinagar airfield and announce formation of a revolutionary council. They would then seek recognition from all countries of the world.
जब ये सब हो जाता है तो हम अखनूर इलाके में ऑपरेशन ग्रैंड स्लैम लॉन्च करेंगे और इसी के साथ जनाब कश्मीर पूरे का पूरा हमारी झोली में होगा।
इंशाल्लाह जम्मू कश्मीर बगैर पूरी जंग लड़े हमारा हो जाना चाहिए
इंशाल्लाह।
Not only was General Musa Khan feeling bypassed, he had serious reservations about this whole plan.
ये अख्तर हुसैन मलिक मुझे बाईपास करके प्रेसिडेंट साहब के पास डायरेक्ट जा रहा है, ये मरा देगा हमको। हिंदुस्तान क्या जवाबी कार्रवाई करेगा ये इन्होंने सोचा ही नहीं। मुझे कुछ ठीक नहीं लग रहा।
1st of August 1965, Pakistan launched Operation Gibraltar. The 9 Pakistani columns infiltrated across the difficult terrain of the line of control. By the 5th of August, they were deep inside Jammu and Kashmir. Unfortunately for them, there was no general uprising and revolt by the Kashmiri people. Quite to the contrary, the local Gujjars informed the army and police, who launched swift operations to round up the infiltrators. By the 12th of August, most of the infiltrators had already fled back across the LC. By 18th August, it was all over for Operation Gibraltar. It had proved to be a complete fiasco. India now decided to hit back hard. Indian troops in the Kargil sector launched surprise attacks on the features dominating the Srinagar Leh road like Point 13620. These Pakistani posts had been harassing our convoys. The Pakistanis were taken by complete surprise and fled these posts.
इस तरह से ऑपरेशन जिब्राल्टर पाकिस्तान के लिए असफल रहा और भारत के लिए एक बहुत बड़ी सफलता मिली, खास करके काउंटर इन्फिल्ट्रेशन ऑपरेशंस जिसमें हाजीपीर पास, लद्दाख के 3 पोस्ट और किशनगंगा के पोस्ट का कब्जा होना भारतीय सेना के लिए एक बहुत बड़ी जीत थी।
The major Pakistani launch pad for infiltration was located in the Uri Punch Bulge with the famous Haji Pir Pass. Pakistan had dumped huge stocks of supplies and ammunition for the Operation Gibraltar forces in this bulge. From the north, 68th Infantry Brigade under the legendary Brigadier Zorawar Chand Bakshi was to lead the assault on the strategic Haji Pir Pass. From the south, 93 Infantry Brigade from the Punch sector was to attack the Raja and Chand Tekri pickets and attempt a link-up with 68 Brigade. The 68 Infantry Brigade offensive was to commence on the 25th of August, but it rained in sheets that night. The attack was therefore postponed by a day. The next night also, it kept raining. However, 1st Para under Major Ranjit Singh Dayal now attacked the formidable sunk picket in pouring rain. The enemy was just not expecting an attack in such foul weather. They were caught by complete surprise and after a token resistance, fled in sheer panic. After a grueling march, Dayal and his men reached the Ladewali Gully the next afternoon. The original plan was for Fort Rajput to now pass through and attack the Haji Pir Pass. Dayal now got permission to press on and capture the pass himself. The men were tired but were inspired by their tough commander for a last push. Major Dayal and his battalion reached some 800 meters below the Haji Pir Pass. They left a small detachment as a fire base to keep the enemy's head down. Then himself, Dayal and his men climbed up the steep right shoulder of the pass. From there they rolled down and charged. Seeing the enemy suddenly emerging from the heights, the Pakistanis were terrified. Major Dayal and Brigadier Bakshi were awarded the Mahavir Chakra for their heroic leadership and courage in this operation. Two brigades then effected a link-up south of the Haji Pir Pass, and the complete Turi Punj bulge was flattened. Pakistan had lost its major infiltration launch pad. There was now panic in General Headquarters that Muzaffarabad itself was now under threat. At this critical juncture, Pakistan now launched Operation Grand Slam. The aim of this operation was to seize the Akhnoor Bridge and decisively cut off the state of Jammu and Kashmir from the rest of India. The attack was launched at 0400 hours on the 1st of September 1965. Pakistan had massed its medium and heavy artillery guns to pound the Indian defenders with a massive barrage. A Pakistani infantry division under Major General Akhtar Hussain Malik attacked the Chump position. The attack was led by two regiments of Patton tanks. 106mm anti-tank gun detachments of the Indian infantry and just one squadron of AMX-13 tanks put up a very stiff resistance. This squadron was led by Major Bhaskar Roy. He tenaciously led his men against amazing odds. Facing him were some 90 Pakistani Patton tanks against just 9 of his light AMX tanks and some anti-tank guns. But due to their tenacity and courage, they delayed the enemy tank attack for one whole day. Major Bhaskar Roy was awarded the Mahavir Chakra for his incredible courage and tenacity. The next morning, the Pakistan Army Chief flew into General Malik's headquarters and sacked him. He sent Major General Yahya Khan to replace him.
Salaam alaikum, Janab.
Walaikum salam, Yahya. Kaise aana hua?
Aapko khabar to mili chuki hogi. Chief sahab aapse bahut na khush hain. Mujhe hukum hai ki main abhi isi waqt aapse Operation Grand Slam ka takeover karunga.
What are you talking, Yahya? All our operations have been going on wonderfully well.
Gustakhi maaf, Janab. चीफ साहब आपसे बिल्कुल सहमत नहीं है. हाजी पीर आप खो चुके हैं. कारगिल के ऊपर दुश्मनों का कब्जा हो गया है और अखनूर की लड़ाई में कुछ हो नहीं रहा है. मलिक साहब, यू फोकस ऑन हैंडलिंग 12th डिवीजन. लेट द प्रोफेशनल हैंडल द अटैक.
वेरी वेल देन याया, आपकी कुर्सी आपको मुबारक हो.
दिस वॉज द सेम याहया खान हु वुड लेटर बिकम द मिलिट्री डिक्टेटर ऑफ पाकिस्तान. By dusk on the 1st September 1965, the situation had become so grim that the army had to ask for urgent air support from the Indian Air Force. By the same evening, 12 Empires and 14 Mysteries roared off to stem the tide. The slow-moving Indian aircraft fiercely attacked the Pakistani advancing columns. General Yahya Khan thereafter took some 24 hours to resume the offensive. Pakistan resumed the attack. Its medium and heavy guns inflicted great damage. Its Patton tanks now broke out and tried to bypass the Indian defenses at Jaudia. By 4th, 5th September 1965, the Pakistani tanks had reached just 4 miles short of the Akhnoor Bridge. The situation was now turning very grim in the Chambaknur sector.
Pradhan Mantri ji, Pakistan ne jo hamla Chamb mein kiya hai, wahan par sthiti gambhir hoti ja rahi hai. Khatra badhta ja raha hai. Humne apni vayu sena ki bhi madad di hai, lekin dabav kam nahi hua hai. दबाव बढ़ता जा रहा है और इस दबाव को रोकने के लिए मेरे विचार से एक ही रास्ता बचता है. हमें पाकिस्तान के विरुद्ध सीमा पार करनी होगी और हमला करना होगा.
जनरल साहब,
अंतर्राष्ट्रीय सीमा पार करने की इजाजत मैं आपको देता हूँ। हमारी सेना जैसा भी उचित समझे पाकिस्तान को जवाब दे देगी। आपकी जवाबी कार्रवाई की योजना क्या है?
प्रधानमंत्री जी, हमारी सेना की दो टुकड़ियाँ हैं, 11 कोर और 1 कोर, जो दोनों कोरें हमले के लिए तैयार हैं।
सर, लेकिन मेरे ख्याल में 1 कोर और 1 आर्मर्ड डिवीजन इतनी जल्दी हमला नहीं कर सकते।
It had initially been decided to launch the Indian counter-offensive with both the 11 and 1 corps simultaneously in the Lahore and Sialkot sector. However, 1 corps mobilization took 2 days, and therefore, to relieve pressure on Cham, it was decided to attack right away with the 11 corps in the Lahore sector.
Harbaksh, आपकी बात सही है। हम वही करेंगे। अभी कृपा करके प्रधानमंत्री जी को आप अपनी प्लान या योजना के बारे में बताएं।
11 corps was to attack in the Lahore sector. This 60,000 strong corps had 3 infantry divisions. 15th infantry division, this was tasked to advance on the Amritsar Lahore Grand Trunk Road and lead onto the Ichogil Canal. 7th Infantry Division was to advance south of Lahore and capture the Barki Bedia area and lead on to the Ichogil Canal. 4th Mounted Division, its task was to advance in the Kasur sector and capture all area up to the Ichogil Canal. General Harbaksh initially wanted India's powerful 1st Armored Division to be also deployed in the Lahore sector.
Harbaksh, ये हम कर नहीं सकते हैं। हमारी इंटेलिजेंस रिपोर्ट के मुताबिक पाकिस्तान की 1 आर्मर डिवीजन सियालकोट सेक्टर में है। ये हमारे लिए खतरा पैदा कर सकती है। मैं चाहता हूं कि हमारी 1 आर्मर डिवीजन सियालकोट सेक्टर में हमला करे और पाकिस्तान की इस 1 आर्मर डिवीजन को वहीं बर्बाद कर दे।
तो ठीक है श्रीमान, आप लोग निश्चिंत होकर आगे बढ़ें। मुझे पूर्ण विश्वास है कि परीक्षा की इस घड़ी में पूरा देश आपके योग्य हाथों में सुरक्षित है।
6
सितंबर 1965 एट 0400 आवर्स इन द मॉर्निंग इंडियाज 11th कोर लॉन्च्ड एन ऑल आउट ऑफेंसिव इन द लाहौर सेक्टर टुवर्ड्स द इचोगिल कैनाल। Our 15th Infantry Division advanced along the Grand Trunk Road highway from Amritsar to Lahore. The Indian assaulting brigades were fiercely engaged by the Pakistani artillery, and the Pakistani Sabre jets began frantic air attacks to stop them. Despite this, 3rd Jat under the command of Colonel Desmond Haig moved up and laid a roadblock at Gosal Deyal. They ambushed and destroyed a Pakistani convoy of trucks escaping towards Lahore. Colonel Haig then pushed on and reached the home bank of the canal by 1100 hours. The Ichogil Canal was 120 feet wide, 30 feet deep, and had 20 feet of water. Colonel Haig pushed on and reached the eastern bank of this canal. In utter panic, the Pakistanis blew up the bridge on the canal at Batapur. The spans of this bridge broke in two. The brave Colonel Haig now led his troops across. 2 companies of the Jats swarmed across the broken bridge and had reached the far bank by 11:30 hours. This was the very first day of the war. It was an amazing feat. Had the Indian Armored Division been allocated to this sector, it could now have exploited this crossing and encircled Lahore itself. Unfortunately, due to confusion, the Indian brigade commander ordered 3rd Jat to fall back. This gave Pakistan the breather to reoccupy its defenses and even launch repeated counter-attacks. Pakistan now turned village of Dograi on the Ichogil Canal into a fortress. battle seesawed. On the last night of the war, Third Jat attacked and captured this Dograi village in a very hard-fought battle. Colonel Haid was awarded the Mahavir Chakra for his bravery and exemplary leadership. As we have seen, Pakistan had launched a dangerous attack in the Akhnoor sector of Jammu and Kashmir. In retaliation, India's 11th Corps had attacked in the Lahore sector of Punjab. By 8 September, India's 1 Corps, which was our strike corps, had moved up for the attack on Sialkot. The aim of attacking in Lahore and Sialkot was to force Pakistan to recoil from Akhnoor and fight to save itself in the Punjab. 8th of September 1965, India's 1st Strike Corps of some 80,000 men launched a fierce offensive in the Sialkot sector. This attack was spearheaded by some 250 tanks of India's 1st Armored Division. It was supported by 3 infantry divisions, the 6th, the 14th and the 26th Division. This massive attack shook up Pakistan. India's 6th Armored Division attacked on the night 7th-8th September to establish a bridgehead for the breakout of the Indian 1st Armored Division. By dawn, it had captured Maharajke and Charwa. Meanwhile, 26th Infantry Division launched a holding attack on the Jammu-Sialkot axis to tie down all Pakistani troops there. By the morning, this division had captured the area of Vajragadi. At the crack of dawn, on the 8th of September, India's 1st Armored Division attacked on 2 thrust lines with its 1st Armored Brigade and 43 Lorry Brigade leading. Unfortunately, it had rained the previous night and the wheel trucks of the Indian Lorry Brigade got bogged down in the slush. This slowed down the Indian attack and gave Pakistan the chance to now move up its 6th Armored Division to Pasroor. The stage was now set for a head-on clash between the 2 armored divisions. This was to lead to one of the biggest tank battles after the Second World War. On 11th September, India's 1st Armored Division resumed its attack using its 1st Armored Brigade and 43 Lorry Brigades as a pincer to envelop the Pakistani pivot at Phillora. A major tank-to-tank battle erupted here. Lieutenant Colonel A.B. Tarapore was leading the 17th Pune Horse. He was a brave and charismatic officer. Over the next 2 days, fierce attacks and counter-attacks took place. In this battle at Phillora, some 50 Pakistani tanks were destroyed for a loss of just 9 centurions. Pakistan's 11th Cavalry Regiment was completely wiped out in this battle with 17 Pune Horse and 4 Hudson's Horse. Colonel Tarapore was severely wounded in his arm during this battle.
LF 25, move to area bridge. I say again, move to area bridge. Over.
Sir, आप ठीक हो सर? हे भगवान, आपको तो बहुत गहरी चोट लगी है. सर, आपको तो पीछे ले जाना पड़ेगा.
Don't be silly, Gali. मामूली सी खरोच है. मेडिकल बुलाओ, पट्टी कर देगा. लड़ाई जारी है, अपने टैंक पे वापस जाओ. इट्स एन ऑर्डर.
कर्नल तारापुर रिफ्यूज टू लीव द बैटल फील्ड. आफ्टर द डिस्ट्रक्शन ऑफ इट्स 11th कैवेलरी रेजिमेंट एट फिलोरा, पाकिस्तान वाज शेकन. इट बिगन टू गैदर ऑल इट्स टैंक रिजर्व्स टू दिस सेक्टर. इट नाउ हैड मस्टर्ड सम 10 टैंक रेजिमेंट टू इंडियाज 5. इट हैड ऑल्सो रिमूव्ड ऑल इट्स हेवी गन्स फ्रॉम अखनूर and deployed them for the defense of Chavinda. On 13 September, the Indian Armored Division resumed its attack on Chavinda. There was very fierce fighting, and Pakistan now brought to bear its heavy and medium guns on the assaulting Indian tanks. Colonel Tarapore's tank was hit and caught fire. Despite being wounded, he picked up his injured officer and driver. He got them to another tank and simply resumed the attack. He was now in the leading tank. Suddenly his tank was hit by an enemy medium gun shell and he was killed on the spot. For his bold and inspiring leadership and his grit and tremendous courage, he was posthumously awarded the Param Veer Chakra. The enemy was shaken by the ferocity of the Poona horse and gave this regiment the title of Fakhre Hind, the pride of India. Overall, in this major tank-to-tank battle, Pakistan lost over 60 tanks. India lost 15 Centurions and 14 Shermans. But the amazing fact is that just 5 Indian tank regiments had got the better of 10 Pakistani tank regiments.
Bharat was the first armored division.
India's first armored division had struck in the Sialkot sector in the hope that Pakistan's first armored division was deployed there. Unfortunately, it was a big intelligence failure. The armored division deployed in Sialkot was not Pakistan's first armored division, but its newly raised 6th armored division. Pakistan's first armored division was then deployed south of both the Lahore and Sialkot sectors in Kasur. Pakistan now sensed a great opportunity. Its first armored division now planned to launch a major counter-offensive from Kasur and in one fell blow reach the Bias Bridge and in the bargain get behind both our attacking corps in Lahore and Sialkot. Field Marshal Ayub in fact thought that once they crossed the Bias Bridge they could strike out for Delhi. Meanwhile, troops of the Indian 4th Mountain Division attacking on the Kasur front had been caught in the open and had taken very heavy casualties from Pakistani artillery and tanks. The units were ordered to fall back to Asaluttar and prepare defenses. A very critical situation was developing for India. This was when General Harbakh Singh moved forward to Asaluttar himself.
Upasthit afsaran aur JCO sahiban, meri baat dhyan se sunen. Aaj ke baad koi withdrawal nahi kiya jayega. 4th Infantry Division yahi lade aur maregi Asaluttar mein. Rohi nale ko tod do, distribution ko breach kar do aur poore ilake ko flood kar. Main chahta hu ki Pakistani Armored Division isi daldal mein barbaad ki jaye.
Four mountain divisions laid mines and consolidated its defenses. The 2nd Independent Armored Brigade was moved down post haste. It had one Centurion and one AMX-13 light tank regiment. They took up ambush positions in the sugarcane fields. As per General Harbakhsh's orders, the banks of the Rohi Nala and its distributaries were breached and the complete area around the Indian defences at Asaluttar was flooded. On 8 September, the Pakistani 1st Armoured Division launched its attack behind a massive artillery barrage. Light screen of Sheffy and Patton tanks led the probing attacks. They ran slap into the Sherman tanks of the Deccan Horse, which were waiting in ambush positions in the sugarcane fields. Pakistan lost 14 tanks, destroyed and withdrew. We'll be right back. Pakistani 4th and 5th Armored Brigades now came up with their battered tanks and launched a headlong attack on the Asal Uttar defenses. The 106mm anti-tank guns of the Indian infantry battalions were waiting in ambush in the sugarcane fields. The 4th Grenadier Battalion came under heavy attack. Company Quartermaster Abdul Hamid was one of its master anti-tank gunners. Hamid took up position in the sugarcane fields, and despite heavy enemy shelling and firing, he kept changing his position and firing on the enemy tanks. In this engagement, he destroyed 4 enemy battered tanks and forced the enemy to call off the attack. Stunned, the enemy armored brigades came back again and launched another fierce attack. Company Quartermaster Havaldar Abdul Hamid had hidden his anti-tank gun in the high Sarkanda and sugarcane fields. He brought effective fire on the advancing enemy tank and blew up the lead one. Despite the heavy enemy shelling and tank and machine gun fire, Abdul Hamid changed positions and destroyed the second tank. All battered tanks in range now engaged his jeep with heavy fire. He was severely wounded, but despite his bleeding wound, he engaged the third pattern and knocked it out even as he died. He was awarded the Paramveer Chakra posthumously for his most gallant act. Shahidon ki mazaron par lagenge har baras mele, vatan pe mitne walon ka yahi baki nishan hoga. On the 10th of September 1965, Pakistan launched its final desperate assault in Asal Uttar. Once again, their tanks were bogged down in the slush and their tracks got jammed. They were shut up one by one by the Indian Centurions, Shermans and AMX-13 tanks. A number of Pakistani tanks were now in flames. The Pakistani General Officer commanding 1st Armored Division, Major General Nasir Ahmad Khan, himself moved up.
Hey, Imam, sorry, Imam. Pakistan ke naam par, main tumhe hukam deta hu, tum aage badho.
Sir, hamare tank dalal mein phans chuke, hum aage nahi bad sakte.
Tum piche badho.
Sir, hum piche bhi nahi aa sakte.
Kya bakwaas hai? Wahi ruko, main aage aata.
Indian Army intercepted this radio conversation. An ambush was laid. Pakistani Artillery Brigade Commander Brigadier Shamim was killed and the shaken Pakistani GOC was wounded. He fled in panic. That was the end of Pakistan's grand offensive. All command and control was lost thereafter. Pakistani tank crews left their patterns in droves to seek out the Indians and surrender. It was a very pathetic end of an extremely ambitious plan of attack. Though the war continued in the Sialkot sector till 22nd September, the fate of the war itself had been decided by 10th September in Asal Uttar. 1965, having completed our pilgrimage of the 1965 war battle sites, we have returned in the end to the battlefield of Asal Uttar, where this war was truly concluded. War that Pakistan had started in Kutch and Kashmir was buried here forever in the slush and swamps of the fields of Asal Uttar. When this sensational news reached the Pakistani General Headquarters, a pall of gloom fell over the place.
जनाब जनाब गजब हो गया, हमारे सारे टैंक दलदल में फंस चुके हैं और बर्बाद हो रहे हैं।
इससे तो पूरा पासा ही पलट गया।
This is terrible.
With the destruction of Pakistan's 1st Armored Division in Asal Uttar, Pakistan had lost its desperate gamble. It now began to look frantically for a ceasefire and exit. Prime Minister Shastri called the Army Chief, General Jain Chaudhary, for consultation.
क्या आपको लगता है कि अगर 10 दिन और ये लड़ाई चलती रहे तो हम कुछ विशेष परिणाम हासिल कर पाएंगे?
कश्मीर इस समय पर पूरी तरह से सुरक्षित है। पाकिस्तान की 1 आर्मर डिवीजन पूरी तरह से विनाश हो चुकी है। हमारा एमिनेशन भी कम होता जा रहा है और दोनों तरफ की काफी भारी तादाद में कैजुअलिटीज हुई है। इस समय पर हमें सीज फायर एक्सेप्ट कर लेना चाहिए।
On 23rd September 1965, as per the UN Security Council resolution, ceasefire was announced and the guns fell silent on both sides. The war came to an end. Bravery is a tradition of our armed forces. In every war, our brave hearts have made tremendous sacrifices. In the 1965 war, our warriors added a new chapter of glory to this tradition of courage and sacrifice. In this war, India lost a total of 3,293 brave hearts. These included 179 officers, 130 JCOs, and 2,984 jawans. There are the lines of that immortal poem: "They shall not grow old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the mornings, we will remember them." In the 1965 war, our senior commanders learned very vital lessons. These resulted in our spectacular victory in 1971 war. The historical process that Pakistan started in 1965 in Kashmir culminated in its breakup in 1971. But that is another story.